We haven't had our first board meeting of the fall, but I hope we'll be organizing another trivia night of our own. But in the meantime, Belmont is having a trivia night at the site of auction. Information is there. And if you haven't looked at or haven't been looking regularly at our website, thanks so much to Keith Kaiser for creating it and keeping it up to date. It's having a website is a lot like, I'm trying to think of the right analogy here. It's a lot like keeping a garden, I guess. You create it, you plant all those seeds, but you just can't stand back and then just say, okay, it's done. It's never done, because you're updating it, you're watering it, you're tilling the soil, you're taking care of the weeds, you're, you know, adding new things to it, and so on. And Keith is very good about that. So every week, if you happen to have fallen asleep during the sermon, or if you missed the service, you can go on to the website and you can listen to today's service in a couple of days once I get that recording to him. And I think, how many Sundays worth of services do you have the recordings of on there, Keith?
Five or six.
So you'll be able to go back over a few Sundays and catch up and see if there were any pearls of wisdom there. Next Sunday, there's only one scripture reading. Next Sunday, we're going to have a hymn sing. And sing all of the remaining hymns that you requested that I haven't been able to fit into the services over the last year. And so bring your singing voices. Don't be screaming too much at a Blue Jays game or at your TV the day before, because we want you all a good voice for that Sunday. And everything else, the information there remains the same. And I thank you very much for your continued prayers and questions and good wishes and so on with my health situation. I will update you. Obviously, I did not have my ankle fused during the 2 weeks that they promised me. So I called the surgeon's office, and there wasn't a space to fit me in. So there's a possibility. The surgeon is off the first and the last week of September. There's a slight possibility they can fit me in there on the second or third week, but more likely in early October for that. But in the meantime, I've had to give up driving. Not because of my ankle, so because the abdominal issues I've been having have robbed me of the ability to sleep. So last night, for example, I had 2 hours of sleep. And so what happens is I drive here in the morning and I'm fine. I was trying to get home. The last time I drove home by myself, I think I fell asleep. I fell asleep 3 or 4 times on the trip. And luckily, nothing happened. It was just, you need to nod off for a couple of seconds. But okay, that's enough warnings. I'm not doing that anymore. So this is where I ask. I'm calling all the favors that have been offered. Many people have said to me, Larry, if the moment comes and the time comes when you need us to drive you to different places to visit people and so on, what I'm going to try to arrange is for friends in Rodney and West Lawrence on to drive me to some point like Wellington Road or Stone Ridge or something like that, and then ask someone to kind of come from this direction, pick me up, bring me, and then just drop me off, and I'll visit with somewhere, and then I'll text you or phone you and say, I can't then here, Doc, and come please and pick me up and take me somewhere else. So thank you for those who've offered. I'm all set for this week. But if you're interested in doing that, just speak to me, or give it a head, and only 2 hours, I probably will forget. So better yet, to send me an email, or just give me a little note, say, yes, Larry, I would do that. And maybe these are the best or the worst days for me, so that I wouldn't be calling on you to drive me around on a Tuesday if you're always busy with something else on Tuesday. So this is another way in which we work together as a team. And so I thank you in advance for your assistance. I don't have any other announcements. Does anyone else? Let us read together in unison our call to worship. God knows each one of us by name, by character, by our friendship, into love with God and with each other, to uphold and uplift us, to heal us of our shortcomings, to make us whole in God's love and in the love of neighbor. Let us worship God. Let us pray together, the opening prayer followed by the singing of the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we come as both the sowers and the seed. We come often feeling small, yet you nurture our branching out. We come to drink of your living water and to share the living water with others. We come to embrace the earthiness of life, knowing that out of it comes our growth into maturity and fullness of mission. Bless, O Spirit, in our shared journey of faith, as we proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Come to this place.
youthful enthusiasm that you bring to the life, so I will blend the children's story into this sermon, so that brings us to the point when we light the Christ candle. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. Jesus is our friend who loves us always. And now Shannon's going to sing for us All Things Bright and Beautiful. Thank you, Shannon. As I said to you when you told me what you were singing, it was bright and beautiful. Let us pray. Ever-revealing God, open us this day to your word. Open us to your way. Open us to your call for us today. Through the pages of Scripture, make your way and will known to us, and your call as compelling as it was to those first disciples long ago. Amen. And our responsive psalm today is Psalm 124, and it's found on page 848. Page 848. But praise be God, who has not given us as a prey to their teeth.
We have escaped like a bird from the hunter's snare. The snare is broken, and we are free.
Gospel reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter
16, verses 13 through 20. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "What do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven has. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Our reading from Matthew today can serve for us as a starting point for us to ponder exactly who we think Jesus is and what role he has in our own lives, both short-term, as in today and this week, but also long-term, in the decades during which we have been Christians and continue to be Christians. Jesus asked the question of the disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" as a sort of test, but a very important one, to see if his teaching about who he is, his ministering, his actions, those people that he's associated with, and so on, to see if they have sunk in. Because we have numerous examples prior to this where they just didn't get it. And even in this reading that Brian just read for us, some people say, "Well, we think you're really John the Baptist, or you're really so-and-so, or you're really so-and-so." They took so long, and of course, when he tells them that he's going to die and go to heaven and then return, they don't want to believe that. They refuse to believe that he's going to be crucified and die. So they don't just take everything that he says at face value. So he wants to know, do the disciples really get it? Or do they still think that he's Elijah or Jeremiah or just another prophet? But when directly addressed the question, Simon Peter gives the answer that Jesus has been hoping for. "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus blesses and names Peter's role in what will become the Christian church after Jesus has left them. And he says, "You are Peter, and on this rock," which is what the word Peter means, rock, "I will build my church." And so we return to the question, how would you reply? Not with the big names so often given to Jesus, such as King of Kings and Teacher and Forgiver of Sins and the Chosen One and the Great Healer. And in our book study last spring, we talked about the names of Jesus. And Walter Brueggemann's book led us through exploring the various lives that are given to him and that Handel used for him in the Messiah. We explored many of those names. Jesus is known and named for many attributes because he interacts with and projects different aspects of himself to different people. And I think all of those different aspects are really a part of who Jesus is. When I like to think of someone or something who has many different qualities, I like to think of that person as a diamond. with many different facets. So if you hold a diamond up to the light and you look at it, you'll see certain facets or faces of it, which will have a reflective quality and may shine different colors or refract the colors. But if you turn it just slightly, you'll see some different facets and faces and so on and so on and so on. And Jesus, I think, is someone slightly different to each and every one of us. Even if we've all heard the same sermons, read the same Bible verses, and sung the same hymns, we come to Jesus out of our own personal needs in our lives. Our hopes, our aspirations, the things we've lost, the conflicts that we have, our hopes and our dreams. And Jesus, as we seek him out, fulfills those for us. So even though you might have a similar background, let's say if you're a twin, you may have totally different aspirations and see different facets of Jesus because of your own personality. Not to say that Jesus changes, Jesus just is a multifaceted person. He's reflecting all of these different aspects of God. So who do you really say that Jesus is? I think one of the greatest challenges for Christians and people of all faiths is to remain true to what you hold dearest and nearest to your heart and how you should live out your life. And we as Christians seek direction from God, from Jesus. When we are asked to confess our beliefs, it's something quite different than confessing our sins, which in itself can be quite difficult to do. Because most of us wear blinkers, I think, a lot of the time, and hide part of the truths about ourselves from ourselves. That's just a fairly common self-protective measure that humans do. But I know it can be a little scary when we are asked to confess who we think Jesus is. So I'm going to go first, but before that, I want to ask you to do something else. In our lives, we play many different roles. We are many different people, two different people in our lives. So I would say of myself, I was a teacher, I was a son, I'm a father, I was a principal, now I'm a minister, I'm a husband, I'm a neighbor. So I just want you to take a couple of minutes and just turn to the person next to you or behind you or in front of you and just say maybe three different roles that are really important to you that you have taken on in your life and that you try to live out. Not that they're necessarily Christian things, but you, because you are a Christian, they are things that you have chosen to live out. So just take a few minutes and do that. always hate to interrupt a good conversation when it's going on, but I'm going to do that. So just put up your hand if you surprised yourself as you were thinking of all the aspects of who you've been, you realize that you thought of some things of who you are or who you have been, that it's not something you typically thought to think of yourself being, but it just sort of popped up today. Oh, you were also all... We had one. Good. I just changed my mind. I'm not going to tell you who I think Jesus is first. I'm just going to ask you to do the same thing. I want you to say one thing. To me, Jesus is... And then you fill in the blank. To me, Jesus is... And share that with the person next to you, who Jesus is. The word that I would come first to mind for me is friend. And that might seem strange, but I think for my whole life, I thought more of Jesus as a human, but more the divinity of Jesus, the Son of God, a holy man, a prophet. But the more I minister, the more I see that he is our friend. And that's accentuating the human side, that he came to earth as God's only Son to be our friend, to be with us in the good and the bad and the ugly and the greatest pains of our lives and the greatest losses of our lives and the greatest love of our life as well, too. God's so big, I think, that we have a hard time connecting with God. And especially, I can remember one of the first things that they talked to us about when we got to Emmanuel in Toronto to start working toward ministry. They said, take that concept you have in your head of God as a man on a big throne somewhere up in the sky with white hair and this long beard, and just forget you ever saw that image. She said, because we're going to replace that with some other ideas about who God might be for you. But as long as you've got that as the dominant image in your head, you're not going to have a feel. It's tough to feel a personal connection with a king on a throne who's so distant and far away. You need to think of God as being much closer, and Jesus as well, too. And because God is many things and is so big, God came to earth to be like one of us, to live like one of us, in order to reveal how God feels about each and every one of us. So in this sense, Jesus reveals to us God's heart. A heart that aches for all of our suffering of depression and loss, and those who think seriously about ending their lives, and quite sadly, each year as school begins, that's one of the high points of the suicides of young people, because they head off, they're away from home, they're away from their families, and they feel overwhelmed by everything. I learned that the hard way. I went to university in Kingston, at Queen's University, stayed in residence, and I went home one weekend, and when I came back, the fellow that lived across the hallway from me in the room across the way that I just got to know, his door was locked and it never opened again. He had stayed for the weekend. He was so overwhelmed with things, he didn't think he had anybody to turn to. So Jesus came to be with us, to help us, to help those people who suffer that kind of pain, deep pain and depression. He's there to be with us now when we hear so often about young black men being shot for no explicable reason south of the border, or when peace officers are shot and killed. Jesus came to provide strength through our hearts when we are torn up in grief, in the situations in our own lives or the situations of violence around the world. It's a heart that loves like only an adoring parent can, and so only wants the best for us, but it's always eager to welcome us home in grace and forgiveness and love. That's what our friend Jesus brings to us. God is love, and Jesus is the human yet divine expression of that love. And all else follows a line after that, including Jesus' personal suffering and sacrifice for us. So this week I would like to challenge you to ponder long and hard about who Jesus is to you. So start that thought, continue that thought process that we started this morning, and consider more how in your life you see Jesus' love in action around you, and how you feel it moving through you. I think often I feel the Spirit move me. Yesterday we were about to leave the house for going to a family reunion, and I just had this very strong impulse. I know it was the Spirit said, wait a minute, before you go, you have to pick up the phone and call on your parishioners. I did. It was not something I planned on doing, but it was something back in my head I needed to do, because I hadn't seen that person for quite a while. So now we come to the Old Testament reading, and you may wonder why these two important passages appear in the lectionary on the same week. But in a reading from Exodus, the story is so familiar. You probably all saw had colored pictures or pictures that you colored of Moses and the bulrushes. When you were growing up, we used to get Sunday Picks, I think it was called, a little cartoon book. And those stories were all told there. I provide some of my favorite early memories and images of the church. And as children in church school, many of us colored in those pictures and saw the Egyptian princess taking the little baby Moses out of the water there on the bank of the Nile River, while his sister Miriam, we assume, stood by watching. And even without deep reflection on the powers that be looming in the background, we had a sense that the day had been saved and that a cute little baby boy would grow up to be a prince, a happy ending to a scary episode. So I also had this feeling of a great similarity in the story of Joseph and his salvation from his murderous brothers, and there's a similarity between that and Moses being taken out of the water and saved. And yet this story is anything but an ending. It puts into motion the Exodus narrative that with God, behind the scenes and more powerful than the powers that be, taking the first steps to the suffering of the people whose ancestors, Abraham and Sarah, so far away and so long ago, had been promised. They had the abundant numbers more than the stars in the sky, and they're overflowing with blessings and have a land of their own. But the Egyptians get jealous. As we so often do about people who are different, people who are seem to be working harder and succeeding more, and Pharaoh therefore demands all of these different attempts to kill off the Israeli people, the Israelites, by having the young male children killed. So even when the Pharaoh puts the Hebrew people in slavery, they continue to multiply so that they can actually be called a nation. And a writer called Scott Hosey observes that Exodus 1:9 is the first time in all scripture where the Hebrew word am, or nation, has been used in connection with the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So the first time they truly become a nation is when they're enslaved. And the power of that blessing given to Abraham, another thinker that many of us have read and some have heard him speak, Walter Brueggemann, I referred to him earlier, the power of the blessing given to Abraham, Brueggemann says, is received in deep jeopardy, for there is always some regime that wants to destroy it. And here we are 2,000 later, and the story is still the same one. Not that I'm saying that all things that the people of Israel are doing are good, because there's some horrible things that they're doing with regard to the Palestinian people, but the people of Israel always find themselves under threat from their neighbors. And so we have in our scriptures today the stories of two men whose task is to lead their people out of darkness, slavery, sin, and despair, to a new hope in Israel in the case of Moses, and of all of the same families again through Jesus. But as we discussed last week, to free us all from sin and sorrow, act like a bridge between us and God. In both stories, we see the Holy Spirit at work, where lives are changed by listening to God. We all have the Holy Spirit and have access to the same answers and wisdom. God's Holy Spirit reveals the truth to us in many ways. We must remain attentive and attuned and listen very, very carefully to hear and receive them. Who indeed is Jesus in our lives? Again, I leave you with that question. What will we do? What do we need to do to follow him by the name and by the love by which we know him?
Thank you.
Who do you say I am? Lord Jesus, you are a Lord who walks beside your people. So we pray for people who walk for justice. You are a Lord who raises up those who are bent low. So we pray for those held down by the grindings of life and the indifference of the world. You are our Lord who feeds the hungry. So we pray for all who long for bread and the means to provide it. You are our Lord who celebrates the small and the insignificant. So we pray for the children and for those who are never noticed. You are our Lord who says, "Follow me." So we pray for courage and faith in our hearts, that we may take up the cross and find it leads to life. And today, Lord, we pray for all those who suffer from illness, all those who travel on to new challenges and new educational institutions and new jobs, for all who travel as they're concluding their holiday season. We pray for all those who suffer physical and mental illnesses, for those who have suffered loss, for all those who are worried about their own health. Remember all that you are, all the different ways that you can be our friend, and help us always to remember to call upon you in these moments of need. We're so very thankful, dear Jesus. Amen. We give what we can and ask that our gifts of our offering be used by your holy power in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Loving God, accept these gifts as thanksgiving for your many blessings.
Accept these gifts as our commitment to your kingdom. Accept these gifts and accept our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is number 331, The Church's One Foundation, number 331.
Thank you.